I'll say one thing.
In a universe.
Ladies and gentlemen, Quasi Life from the Super Tor Time Phase Shifted Fabulous Crow's Nest. Nestled somewhere between Elysium and Oblivion, it's the Blinky Moskowitz Show with Blinky Moskowitz. Tonight's guests, Donald Rumsfeld action figure. I am your presenter, James I. O'Neill, but my friends call me Jimmy. And now it's my pleasure to announce a fine man, better than any 10 of his clones, Blinky Moskowitz.
Much, Jimmy, for that fantastic intro. You know, I've noticed this in the short time that you've been working here. You're starting to lose your accent a little bit. Now, remember, Jimmy, this is the United States of America, which we were, as we were taught many, many years ago in the old way of teaching children. We weren't really the melting pot. It was cultural pluralism, right? We don't come to this country, abandon our culture anymore and try to become one homogenous type of person called an American, right? No. We come here to be culturally plural. We fall under the same protections of the Constitution, that kind of progress that was made, human rights, due process of law, right to privacy, right to happiness. Yeah? Well, anyway, thanks, Jimmy. This is Blinky. We're back. It's Monday, 3:22 p.m. This show is being sent out in irregular intervals for no reason whatsoever. But I like to remember one of my favorite movies, Pump Up the Volume. It occurred to me as I was fretting about my perceived self-perception of procrastination. It occurred to me that the main character in Pump Up the Volume, who had a pirate radio station, he ran out of his basement or his garage. I can't remember which. He didn't broadcast regularly. He went down and turned on his equipment when the moment struck him, when the dramatic moment, when there was a necessity for him to talk, communicate, share his feelings, commiserate with this student body. It's a fantastic film. If you haven't seen it, it's an old film. It takes place in ancient times, before the internet, before cell phones, where a kid actually becomes popular by broadcasting a pirate radio station, and it upsets the status quo of this dehumanized world of the adults. You got to see it. It's great. It's great. Someday we'll have a film festival. We'll watch that. And we'll watch Brick, and we'll watch, we'll throw in The Breakfast Club. We have to, of course, include John Hughes there. But it's a great film. Features Scott Paulin, actually, who's a member of the Open Fist Theater Company. He plays the father, loving father, but completely incapable of understanding what his son is going through. It's a really great tale of alienation. I think it came out in 1990. And just check it out. Check it out. Anyway, we're back in the crow's nest here, and I'm going to play for you some Blunt.
We'll be right back.
Minimum wage here in the crow's nest. This is Blinky. I might have to call the show early today. I think I exhausted myself on that first song. All right. All right, I'm going to rally. I'm going to get it back. Anyway, last week, I promised you there would be some guests on the show, so we've got a few people coming up. As you know, the great documentary filmmaker, Errol Morris, who can count among his many glories, The Thin Blue Line, Fog of War, has just released a new picture. This is, it's called The Unknown Known, making use of one of my favorite turns of phrase. Anyone who knows me knows that I've been fascinated with the Rumsfeldian Rumsfeldisms ever since I read the article in the New Yorker a few years back where I first heard about his use of the expression, among other things, the unknown unknowns. We'll let him explain it. He's going to be on the show. He's coming up in just a couple of minutes. He's actually been in the green room since yesterday. I want to just thank him and also Blackard Larch, who's a really funny guy. We were supposed to tape the show yesterday, but then we realized that nobody had bought any tape. And then it took a while for us to remember that we don't use tape. And so then there was a little bit of a delay there. And then took a nap, I think. Anyway, they were in the green room all day yesterday watching, I think it was This is the Army with Ronald Reagan. Great. They showed a lot of patience, and I appreciate that. He was Secretary of Defense under George W. Bush. He was Secretary of Defense under Gerald R. Ford, briefly, in the mid-1970s. As I just said, the great Errol Morris has a film coming out on him. I think it was released just this past weekend. And so, in keeping with that, please welcome to the show our first guest, Donald Rumsfeld, talking action figure. Well, first of all, Mr. Secretary, may I please extend my thanks. It is a great honor to have you on this show. I know you're a very busy man, and so it's much appreciated. First of all, how have things been going? Are you involved in any way with the junkets and so forth of the film, or is that just its own animal?
Oh, goodness. I don't think so, although that's what I think.
Oh, okay. Do you feel that the film is a fair portrayal of you?
Pam was the last question for the day, and the good Lord willing for the year.
Well, thanks for that. When you were the Secretary of Defense under George W. Bush, you and General Myers were in charge of deploying troops to Afghanistan in the hunt for bin Laden. Were you disappointed when bin Laden, having been cornered at Tora Bora, managed to slip away from you?
Well, Dick calibrated me, but the first thing I'd say is I don't believe you have the war plan. A fact which does not make me unhappy.
Well, Okay. A lot of people look at you and I should say a lot of people think of you as kind of a ridiculous person, someone who rose to a very powerful position but really doesn't have a lot of brains to back it up, and like a lot of people in positions of power, just kind of bungles it.
The administration does not have a perception. I have a perception. General Myers has a perception, and we say what we think.
And what do you think? Do you think this is fair? What people say about you, that you are vapid, smug, self-congratulatory, really as a cover for really just there being nothing there at all?
We do have a saying in America: if you're in a hole, stop digging. Not sure I should have said that.
Are you considering a future in politics?
The nexus between terrorist states with weapons of mass destruction, in this case chemical and biological and nuclear technologies and knowledge, and terrorist groups, networks, is a critical link.
Okay, well then how do you explain the critical link if there actually were no weapons of mass destruction? Doesn't the link just vanish?
Oh, it was your rhetoric that made us do it. And it turns out they had started doing all this well before President Bush came into office, well before the Axis of Evil speech. It's utter nonsense.
Well, I understand. I know that President Clinton also declared bin Laden an enemy, launched cruise missiles at a place next to near where he was for a little while or something like that.
I suspect that some of these dead enders will be down there shooting people and doing that type of thing.
Isn't that more about Iraq, though? Aren't you talking about...
We have done so much in the last 2 years.
I know.
And it doesn't happen by standing around with your finger in your ear hoping everyone thinks that that's nice.
No, of course not. I wouldn't think that anyone would think that would be nice, especially if it was your finger in my ear.
The only choice one has is to proceed and use coercion.
Coercion? You mean like, you know, torture?
This is a case of the local liar coming up again and people repeating what he said and forgetting to say that he never, almost never, rarely tells the truth.
We're going to be back with more with the Donald Rumsfeld action figure after this.
I hope it's not the end of the world, 'cause I feel good about life right now. And I hope it's not the end of the world, 'cause I don't want the world to end. Ever since I was a little kid, I've been worrying about the end of the world. And maybe sometimes I didn't care, 'cause I was mad, didn't know why. But these days things are going good and I feel fine. Now my heart is on the mend, so I don't want the world to end. And I hope it's not the end of the world, 'cause I feel good about life right now. And I hope it's not the end of the world, 'cause I don't want the world to end. I used to dream I was staring down the most true cloud, just waiting to be blown away. But that was yesterday. Now I find I'm thinking about the future more and more. So please don't blow up the world, 'cause I just met a pretty girl. And I hope it's not the end of the world, 'cause I feel good about life right now. And I hope it's scares me. Watch TV, it scares me. See the world, it scares me. It's the pain that burns your soul. Go to work, it scares me. Read the paper, it scares me. Feel empty, it scares me.
Okay, we are back. That's a tune called End of the World by Makepeace. Little known fact, Makepeace played all the parts himself. He's a Renaissance man. Anyway, I'm back with little known fact. Anyway, that's actually my friend Mike Makepeace. He gave me that CD he made. It's from a CD called American Robot Rock and Roll. And it's completely obscure, but that's why I'm playing it on this show, because you want to get your Led Zeppelin on, man. Turn on the radio. Everything's all good. Anyway, we're still here talking to Donald Rumsfeld action figure, who has a lot to say.
Analysts say what they say, and quite honestly, they seem to me to be all over the lot.
Thanks for that. And as you, we're back, and okay, we're talking about the truth. We're talking about the truth versus personal narrative. We're talking about a baseline reality versus individual perception. And aren't you the perfect example of that? Because it seems to me, observing you through the years in the media and in your personal statements, that you have formed an idea, an image, a self-image that might not be the same as the image that others have of you.
It's inaccurate. I have not opined on that subject.
Well, you don't want to talk about that for a second?
I'm working my way over to figuring out how I won't answer that.
Well, I mean, doesn't this get to the crux of all politics and public life and human power?
I mean, that's not even a remote possibility.
What isn't?
The answer is yes and no.
Which I didn't answer which question?
How did you get a camera into my private office? Who in the world lets you in there?
We'll talk about that later. But let's get back to the idea. Can you tell me in 10 words or less, who is Donald Rumsfeld?
Oh, my goodness.
Okay. Is that an answer, or was that...
Do you want to know if you could offer me the opportunity to answer? The answer is yes, you may offer me the opportunity, and I decline.
Well, I mean, you came on the show, and we're 20 minutes in. Why don't you give it the old college try, Don?
The question you ask, however, is not a question I can answer.
You're the only person who could answer this question.
I don't know.
What do you mean you don't know? Of course you know. You're you. If you don't know what you think of you.
I mean, if you just don't like one word answers.
I said I gave you 10 words.
The statement I made is sound as a rock.
Iraq?
I didn't say Iraq.
Look, just okay. You know, let's skip it. Let's skip it. Why don't you tell me? Well, listen, you and the other neocons have been attempting to force your own particular kind of will on this country ever since the 1968 election that put Richard Nixon in office. I mean,
I shouldn't get into this. Is diplomacy, and I don't do diplomacy.
No, this is not diplomacy, Mr. Secretary. This is politics.
How do you feel about the progress that you and your fellow neoconservatives have made in the last...
What they do with themselves is up to them, and what the people around them do with them is up to the people around them.
But what do you... What?
I would not say that the future is necessarily less predictable than the past. I think the past was not predictable when it started.
I have no idea what that meant.
The message is that there are known knowns. There are things we know that we know. There are known unknowns. That is to say, there are things that we now know we don't know. But there are also unknown unknowns. There are things we do not know we don't know. And each year we discover a few more of those unknown unknowns.
Donald Rumsfeld action figure, ladies and gentlemen. We'll be right back.
I believe what I said yesterday. We'll be... I don't know what I said, but I know what I think. And I assume it's what I said.
All right, let's go.
Oh, is about to go down.
He's so tense. He's so tense. Oh, that man. He's very tan. He's 2 inches shorter than she is. And he's, well, you know, tan. Oh, that man is very.
I believe what I said yesterday. I don't know what I said, but I know what I think. And I assume it's what I said.
All right, folks, we're back here. This is Blinky. Just heard a nice little set of songs there. Ma's Furnace with the first song, and then the freaky jazz edit version of He's So Tan by the Savage Weasels, Expanding Waistband, Black Fudge, and Trouser Steam. Well, folks, we're winding it on down here. That's all the time we have for today's show. I would like to thank Donald Rumsfeld's action figure for completely confusing me. And I'd like to wish the best to all the folks out there. Listen, when you go to the Hollywood Fringe Festival this summer, make sure you see Refried Bean, starring Michelle Lima. Don't miss it. This is Blinky. Thanks for spending a half hour with me. You know, a good half hour, that's half an episode of Star Trek. I appreciate it.